You know, currently on my TV screen right now, Blake, I'm watching the highlights of this game.
Oh, boy.
I'm watching the highlights. And every time I look over, I notice one reoccurring theme about every single damn play that I see. Every single damn play that I watch, I see the same thing. I see it every single time that they show it on the television.
Can I take a guess? Can I take a guess?
Oh, you can take a guess, Blake.
Let me think.
Think about
it. Could it possibly be one of either a man named Dorian Finney-Smith, Jalen Brunson, or Maxi Kleba standing on one of the corners, wide open for three?
Oh, man. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a genie on our hands. He guessed it spot on. That is the story about tonight's game. My goodness, could the Jazz not play perimeter defense if their life depended on it? My goodness. If I had another for every time there was a wide open Dallas Maverick, I could take you all to the Bahamas on a 7-night vacation because, my goodness, every single time they are wide open, even if they missed it, it didn't matter. Wide open. Blake, how many threes did the Dallas Mavericks hit tonight?
Enough.
It doesn't even matter how many. They hit so many. Just Jalen Brunson, six three-pointers. What's that one dude's name? The one dude.
Kleba.
Kleba.
Yeah.
That's just,
seven threes.
Seven threes, man.
Seven or eight. It might have been eight. It is ridiculous. For a guy who is like, this is really frustrating. It's the same as Tyrese Maxey, but take Tyrese Maxey and like oversize him by 7 feet. It's like Gobert is either blind and doesn't know how to switch. Because in the last game, let me tell you this, man. He dominated. He didn't touch the ball twice. And the guy was just, he was rotating fantastically. He was able to cover the guys who he was able to absolutely smother the Mavericks. In this game, it looked like Maxi Kleba was an unidentified object that Gobert had never seen before. Which he has seen him before, and he's limited him to like 3 points. It's not impossible to guard him on
Wait,
the perimeter
I
at all. He's a huge target.
Because I just have to make this. They're pulling up a graphic. I'm going to give you the rebounds of two teams. One team, and this is a huge difference in the game, right? This is what can win.
Oh!
One team had 50 rebounds, and one team had 31. Which team won the game? The team with 50 or 31?
I know who it is.
It's got to be the team with 50 rebounds, right? No! The Jazz had 50 rebounds. They out-rebounded the Mavericks by 19 and lost. Because the Mavericks hit 22 threes. 22! I just don't understand it. The Mavericks only had 28 points in the paint. Utah also had 10 turnovers. Dallas only 3. Kleba had 25 points, man. That just cannot happen in a playoff game. It just can't. And it's the same thing that we saw against the Clippers in round.
No, and not just that, but also, like, look at this. So 11 for 29, that was the Jazz stat line from outside in this game. Now, let's take a look at the Mavericks, 22 for 47. Now, I guarantee if I could pull up the stat line from games 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 from the Clippers, you will just see an astounding amount of threes taken by the other team. A huge amount of threes taken by the other team. What happens is these teams, they understand that without a big centerpiece, you can't go inside with Rudy Gobert. So let's downsize. Let's start moving the ball faster. Let's get it to guys. And let's penetrate. Let's kick. And then let's kick it again. And then you're going to find guys like Kleba. You're going to find Finney-Smith. You're going to find Jalen Brunson. Even though Brunson is the main ball handler, you guys. And you're just going to be able to get up as many shots as you could possibly imagine. And the frustrating thing is that it was just never defended well. 22 for 47. That is almost 50%. Nearly 50% on 50 threes. That's insane. That is absolutely bogus.
That is no, it's not bogus. That just shows you how bad our perimeter defense is. And I'll still to this day.
But you have to give them props. You have to give them props for knocking down the threes.
You gotta give them props. They knocked down the
but it's
wide
frustrating. It's frustrating.
I would hope so.
And look, the Mavericks played a great game tonight. And they really did. They infiltrated everything that the Jazz had done in that first game, flipped the script. Now it's 1-1. That's what you had to do if you were Dallas. You got it done. That's a tough, gritty win. And you just exposed the balls out of Gobert. You exposed the crap out of Gobert.
We haven't even talked about Luka Doncic one.
And let me touch on that real quick. I want to make the same point that I made on stream. Made on stream. There we go. Good. Thank you for the grammar correction.
Yeah, of course.
But look, so I was talking about this earlier. The thing about Doncic, again, is that with a injured calf, guys like that who are very shifty, they like to get in the middle of defenses, kind of contort themselves so they can make shots, a lot of turnarounds, a lot of pivots. That's what they do. For Doncic, it is going to be so tough for him to play with that kind of injury. And I want to really emphasize this. I don't know how this team is going to function now when they get him back. Because Brunson, he just dropped 41. He is a capable starting point guard. And I believe he comes off the bench for this team when Doncic is not... Or when Doncic is in, am I correct in saying that? If he's not on the bench, he's a shooting guard, and he is most definitely not their primary scorer. He is going to be, I don't want to say flustered, but knowing that he can do more if Doncic was gone. And I feel like it's really important to recognize that their offense is not going to function the same way as it did. They will be completely flipped because, look, when you score as many points as Brunson just did, you want more of the pie. And I feel like I talk about this all the time. But when you want more of the pie, you get selfish. You don't want to pass to Luka because you know Luka's going to take it in and try to drop a bucket. And if he's not going to drop a bucket, he'll try to maneuver around Gobert and drop it for Dwight Powell or Maxey or anybody else, but not to the other primary ball handler. And that's going to be what's tough for Jalen Brunson and, you know, all the other guys, is that they're going to have to understand. I don't know what's up with Reggie Bullock. He's just not playing up to what he needs to play to. I don't know what his stat line was tonight. But again, all of these guys are getting more touches than they usually do. And I don't know what that means for the future of the Mavericks. I don't really care. All I care about is that the Jazz need to figure out what this team is going to look like when Luka's back, because more than likely he will be back. And I do want to say this, though. I am not sure if the Mavericks are better off playing a half Luka or playing a red hot no Luka, you know? And I don't know right now, because when you insert a guy like that, he demands touches, right? But what if those touches aren't producing how they were when he wasn't even in the game? That's really what I would look at, right? In this game, Bullock had 11 points on 4-for-7. In some of the games that he played against the Jazz, I mean, that's not a bad game by any means. In some of the games he played against the Jazz, he had 25. Dinwiddie still didn't perform how he needed to tonight, 6-for-18. The main guy in this game, the main two guys in this game, Jalen Brunson and Maxey Kleber. Maxey Kleber, fantastic game. Immaculate. Eight three-pointers for him, 6 rebounds, 3 assists. How the heck did this team win? I don't even understand it. Dwight Powell had 1 rebound, man. Gobert, let's see his rebound numbers. 17. And listen. I last point here, and then I'll let you talk for a minute. But the thing that's really weird about Gobert, again, he gets 5 touches in this game. Five shots, I should say. 2-for-5. And here's the thing. You make those 3 layups, because I know for dang sure that he's not taking anything outside of 10 feet. If you make those shots in the paint, then this game is tied. And if you make those shots in the paint, there's probably an and-one in there. Okay? And that's a problem, especially when you have 7 rebounds and 4 offensive rebounds, because I know that those are putbacks that you could have made. You know? And that's the frustrating part. Gobert finished this one with 8 points, 17 rebounds, which is great, but again, how many of those are kickouts? How many times are you finding the open guy on the perimeter who's knocking it down? But those guys weren't knocking him down tonight. You know, and that's another problem for another day. But I just feel like the efficiency right now isn't there with the Jazz. I don't know what's up with it. And it's just honestly like they were up by 8 heading down the stretch. Again, the collapse is real. The collapse is real. It's hard to watch. You see Donovan kind of collapse towards the end. Again, he came in.
He had a great game.
Great game. Great game.
And he just, again, lost his touch.
Lost his touch,
but
man.
But listen, I don't even want to talk about this game anymore. I'm going to be honest.
Yeah, it's not good.
The important thing is to come back game 3 and win.
Yeah, you know, exactly.
I know that it seems that, you know, Blake and I, like, hate this team right now. It's not that we hate this team. And those that know us know it. But if it's your first time watching, we don't hate this team. We're really damn passionate about it. And
And we know that they can. They're. We know that they're capable of more. We know, man. We've seen it. We know this team can knock down freaking 25 threes in a game. We've seen them do it multiple times. We've
seen them shut down the perimeter when they really want to.
We have. We've seen Donovan perform in the clutch. We've seen him do it. And it's not all his fault. It is his fault, but it's not all of his fault. He's in his own head. It's not just him not wanting to play hard. He's playing hard. He's not in a good state when he gets into the clutch. He gets tense and he makes bad decisions. It's all this kind of stuff. We know that they're good.
The whole thing, but listen, you split on the road, right? If Luka was healthy and the Jazz split, you know, Blake and, you know, we'd be happy. But
yeah, we'd be super happy, man.
We're more disappointed because we should be up 2-0 in the series. However, you're going back into Utah with the split.
Yeah.
You've got one of the best home court advantages in the playoffs in the entire NBA, if not the best home court advantage. So the Jazz need to regroup, figure out a game against the three-point perimeter, and go from there.
And come in with an underdog mentality.
Bare minimum, you have to get one at home. If you lose both, this series is over.
Oh, more than over, yeah. This is done.
You have to win one. And I'm not going to say Thursday night is a must win because I don't think it is. But Thursday night is such a key game. And we hope to see you guys in on that stream. We will be live at 8:45 p.m. Eastern time. For the Jazz and Mavericks
game. I do. Let me make one last point here.
You can end it off.
So, when I look at how important this game is for the Jazz, not only do you have the advantage of being at home, you know, you have your fans, you have a chance to go out and show out and really show this Mavericks team who's boss at home. You have to come in with the exact same mentality that they came into this game. The Dallas Mavericks came into this game, not the Utah Jazz. They probably had a fine mentality, but the Mavericks come in, they're the underdog. They're going to have to fight against a team who is really favored to win this. And if they win this, that the 2-0, if you took both games at home, that would have been insurmountable for the Dallas Mavericks. And I absolutely 100% believe that. Now you have a chance if you're the Mavericks, but you have a chance if you're the Jazz. You can't get down on yourself. Come in with the winner's mentality. Come in with the underdog mentality and get the job done.
Chip
on the shoulder. Absolutely. And that's all I got. So we will see you guys Thursday night. What is the time on that game?
8:45 p.m. Eastern. 8:45 p.m. Mountain Time for the Utah Jazz and Dallas Mavericks game. If you did enjoy this video, make sure to give it a big thumbs up. I know this wasn't, you know, the happy, joyous video.
No,
maybe
no.
You guys were hoping for.
So what you got? This is what you got. I think I feel like in times like this, we give you better analysis and we really break down what's going on because it freaking sucks to lose. It's especially in games like this. Especially in games like this where you can just see the flaws. They poke out at you like a freaking stick. It's hard not to see, and that's what we did today. We hope you enjoyed your 14-minute post-game show, and we will see you on Thursday night at 8:45 p.m. Eastern time for Game 3 of the Jazz versus the Mavericks in the first round of the Western Conference playoffs, or the NBA playoffs, whatever. All right, we'll see you guys later. Good night.